Good to see you. Hey, Aaron. How's life?
Oh, it's pretty good. You yourself?
Well, good, man.
Mic's working? Yep, it is working.
Yep, mic's working. Yeah, I think it's all good. Oops, my microphone is hot on Twitch. There we go.
I am streaming to my personal channel tonight.
Oh, nice. Oh, good. Yeah, I like to see how it comes out.
I don't know if there's any viewers or not.
Well, that's a great way to... I never thought about that. Like, when people want to stream, have them do, like, create their own channel and stream on it. I never thought about that. Yeah, what's up, Zach?
Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah. Yeah, sound clear.
Hey, can you hear me? Good, good. Okay. I got a air conditioner blowing next to me, so I wanted to make sure it wasn't drowning me out or anything.
Sounds good to me, man. What's good, man? When you so you got a new job, or you're about to, or what's the latest?
I start tomorrow, the new job.
Whoa, is that that smaller team you were telling me about, or was it?
That's the one I was telling you about. No, it's not that one. They passed on me. They had somebody else that is probably a better fit for them, so that works. But this is with a new company, and they do. Software for to run a mental health care practice.
Yeah.
So it's everything from appointment booking and taking notes and billing and e-scribing and all that kind of stuff.
Oh,
so I'll be in charge of that product and the features that go into it and talking with customers, make sure we're building the right thing, stuff like that.
Nice, nice.
So, yeah.
In the near future, I don't know what that means, maybe August, mid-August sometime, I'm going to connect you with a guy who comes to this service. He has a, what's the word, marketing boutique? I don't know what the word is. But anyways, he was offering to do, like we have VR Church and MMO Church websites, but like a combo one, VR MMO Church and WordPress. And so I'm a Squarespace guy just because of its simplicity for a non-designer like me, but you have... that WordPress experience.
Sure.
So I wanted, you know, maybe after you get settled in your job or whatever, we can connect with him so you can pick his brain about the WordPress stuff.
I like this. I got little.
Yeah, sounds good, man. Love to.
Cool, man. Thanks, man. Appreciate it. What's up? What's up, Victor?
All right.
Oh, I like the new setting.
Hey, yeah.
All right, I'm going to sneak in here and look at our services real quick.
So yeah,
so
cool,
I get
man.
The layout in my mind.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I'm ready.
Marco!
Hey, what's up, DJ?
How are you doing?
I'm fine, thanks. And you?
Oh, I'm doing really well. Keeping busy.
Cool. We're going to wait inside.
All right, take care.
Yeah, I had dinner.
Hey, what's up? Hey, Wonder.
Hey, how
hey,
you doing?
Hey, Maria, how are you?
Hi, DJ. Good. Good. Yeah, we're good to go. See you later.
Hey, see you later. Good to see
you. See you later.
See you too.
Hey, yeah. Okay. Hey, Melody. I like your hat. Have you always had that hat like that? I feel like that's new. Yeah? That's pretty sweet. I think it looks fly. Is that what you young adults say these days? Fly or slamming? I think it looks slamming. Hopefully I'm not saying a bad word in any of these young vernacular words. You mind hitting the countdown for me? Sweet. Thanks, Melody. Hey, Glass. How you doing?
Hello.
Hey, good to see you.
What's up?
Not much. Wait a minute. Did you change your name again?
Wait a minute.
You sneaky. You can't get it. It takes me a minute, but I got you. I got you.
You got me.
Sneaky. Just no Starfire. What are you young kids saying these days, Starfire? You young adults, what are the hip words? Smoking, slamming. What is it? Hey, what's up? Hey, Sentinel. You want to spread germs? I feel you, Starfire. I feel you. Dope. I'll use that one. Or just dope in general. Dope. So dope. Is there an age limit to use the word dope? I'm 42. Is there a... Am I still in the age bracket for the dope category? Or do I have to use like gnarly and excellent?
There's Andrew VR over there. He's from the UK. He's been in Alt Space for 4 years. This is his first time coming to VR Church, so you could really say hi to him. Sorry for stealing your friends.
That's right. Did she change her name?
Yeah, she did.
Was she the future queen of hell earlier?
Yeah, she used to be the future queen of hell. She then changed her name to future queen of pogs. And now she goes by Glass.
Ah.
Which I think Glass is a more...
I didn't recognize her voice.
Hey, Cheddars.
Mm-hmm, and her demeanor and everything. You know?
Yes.
Well, my apologies for the interruption, Cheddars. I have an announcement to make during the VR MMO part, the graphic. So, if you don't mind, just call me up.
Just hand the stage off to you at that slide.
Yeah, and then I'll hand it back for you to wrap it up. Yeah.
Cool.
Thanks,
man. That's
great. Hey, everybody.
Thanks, Cheddars.
Welcome to Virtual Reality Church. My name is Alina, and I'm a pastor here at Virtual Reality Church.
Volume.
And behind me here, we have our
did you
church
connect?
Family
did you
from
connect
all
with Andrew
over
VR?
Over
did you?
And everyone
White Bear.
Is welcome at Virtual Reality Church. It doesn't matter.
White Bear.
Oh, I'm sorry.
White Bear is dope.
He stayed muted for a while with me, too. But then
so
I asked
dope.
Him, like, where is he from? He unmuted. And then I asked how long he was in Alt Space and unmuted. So he does talk when you ask him very direct questions. Hey, Squirrel Hunter.
Hey, what's up?
Not much.
Like
worship's
Christmas
about... Yeah,
I'm better
I
than
like
using
the Christmas colors. Why can't I wear Christmas all the way year round, right? It's a very
branchy. All year round.
Yeah.
You can go right into the worship song.
Worship, right?
Yep.
Church. VR.
Yep.
Thanks, Melody.
So this is our first worship song, so I'm gonna go ahead.
Oops, that was muted. Thanks, Melody.
Welcome to
the Muchas gracias.
Your promise and your spoken truth and give to give me life through you. I'm now brand new. So I will stand in your promise and your spoken truth and give you all.
Can you guys hear Cheddar's right now? Is that me? Can you hear Cheddar's? You can hear him?
And amen, amen, amen. So once again, thank you for coming. We're still in season 4, but we're looking forward to season 5 coming up very soon. And we want to just remind everyone to focus on love, prayer, and destiny, because prayer is for everyone. It can be done in groups or alone. And it's just a conversation with our Lord Jesus. And it's as simple as talking to him. So we really encourage everybody, if you haven't been doing already, get in there and spend some time in prayer. But destiny, on the other hand, we're focusing on, since each person here has a destiny. And one way we try to foster that discovery is by providing of what the destiny is by providing a spiritual gift desk on Discord, so that you can lean on the strengths God has given you, as well as lean on God's strength in your weaknesses. But just to remind you, everyone is welcome here at Virtual Reality Church. Doesn't matter if you believe in God or not, your age, your caste, your race, region, disability, nationality, sexual orientation, or political party. It doesn't even matter if you're a Rust, Final Fantasy 14, or any other game user. You are a precious creation of God and loved so deeply by him. So just remember that everyone here is a person behind that avatar. So be respectful to one another. Love each other as Christ has loved you. Anyways, if you want to get more connected, our website is a good place to start, simply vrchurch.org. And this is where you can join the Discord server and the Telegram announcement server. And don't forget, you can make life easier by taking a photo by pressing the button under the blue menu button. And when you take a photo of the URL, then you can look at the photo later to type it in. You can find out all kinds of things on the website, though, from like who these pastors are in the physical world to what kind of projects we're looking forward to doing in the future. And also, we have a Twitch stream at twitch.tv/VRChurch that can be used for people who don't have VR. And this is especially useful to show off friends and family the crazy joy you're experiencing here at VR Church. And yeah, now I believe the next slide coming up, DJ Soto has a special announcement, and I'm excited to hear it.
Check, check, 1, 2, 3. Okay, there we go. Yeah. I think I got my, did I get my microphone on? Okay, great. Hey, everyone. Yep. I want to welcome you to VR Church. It's so good to see you. And I want to just give my welcome because I don't know what part of the world you're from. It could be morning or afternoon or evening. And I just want to do a quick volunteer highlight. So this is something that's new in the service where we're trying to recruit some volunteers to help us with some certain things in the church. And let me read out a couple of things that we need help with. And by the way, there's many, but here's a few that are at the top of the list. The one is we're looking for more streamers to join our stream team. We stream 4 different services across the metaverse on a Sunday. And we need a team of streamers to be able to, you know, help out with that load. Sometimes I'm streaming and preaching at the same time. So it would really be a big help if you would consider that. Maybe you stream before, you're familiar with Twitch and something like OBS, or perhaps you're really technical able and you don't mind being trained. We can definitely train you in that area. So consider that. We're trying to build that whole team. It's not just one person we're looking for. We're looking for a whole team so you can we can spread the load. You know, maybe twice a month or once a month you can stream. So we're trying to make it to the point where it's not like an every week type of thing. So that's one thing I'd love for you to think about. The other one is the prayer team. We could love to have people who feel comfortable praying for others, who have a love for others, to pray for people after the church service. So we'd love to have you join our prayer team. The other one is a greeting team. You know, we know it's so important is that first impression, people coming in, because it is intimidating to come to church. I wish that wasn't the case. I wish people all over the world felt completely comfortable going into churches. But I think, you know, just all that's going on, the election season and all that, and I don't want to get into anything too political, but I think there is an apprehension when it comes to faith, religion, spirituality, walking in the church, walking in the doors of a church. Are they going to be friendly? Are they going to be judgmental? Is it going to be crazy? So we need a really important ministry of greeting people. I know that doesn't sound like a big thing at all, but it's actually really, really important, very important. We also need that for our Twitch stream. Like host Crystal right now, she's greeting people on the Twitch stream. So if that's something that you would consider doing, and I'll tell you how you can contact me here in just a second. So we got the stream team, the prayer team, the greeting team, and also the build team. The build team is what builds the sermons every week. Now, quick note, the build team is on a little bit of a vacation. So yours truly built this world out here. So it's not what you're used to with Pastor Alina and her team building these like and fantastic worlds that you see like in Inception or The Matrix or whatever. So you'll just have to excuse me. I did a little bit of what I could. But I think you'll enjoy it anyways. But anyways, if you're have built in Altspace VR, or you would love to learn more about building in Altspace VR, because in all these volunteer positions, we do provide training. So here's what you're going to do. If you're interested, because I know life is busy, we got work, school, we're trying to just barely keep your head above water. But if you're like, you know, I have a couple hours, you know, during the month, or, you know, an hour a week or all those things, you know, I would love to help out. Well, here's what you do. If you haven't joined our Discord server, go to vrchurch.org. At the top right of that website, you're going to see a link that says Discord. That's like social media if you've never been there. So you're going to go in there to our particular server, and what you're going to look for is a channel called Tickets. And you're going to click on that channel, and there's going to be a button that says Volunteer for VR Church. So you're going to click on that volunteer for VR Church button, and that's going to send me a message, and we can have a conversation about what position you would like to volunteer for. Now, here's what's beautiful about this. If you click that button, you're not signing your life away. You're not, you know, committing, you know, your whole life to it. It's just to say, hey, I'm interested. Can I learn more? And that's all that there is. So I want to put you at ease because some of you are like, well, I don't want to commit to something if I can't do it. Well, don't worry about that. Just click the button and we'll have a conversation about the hours, the schedule, see if it fits. And if it doesn't, you know, maybe something in the future can work out. But if it does, man, I would love to have you consider volunteering at VR Church in these areas. And there's others, but these are the ones we're highlighting at the moment. So Discord, tickets, volunteer for VR Church. You're not committing. Just let me know when you submit a ticket, what you're interested, and we'll have that conversation. And so thank you so much for that consideration, because I know there's a lot going on. We're busy. Life is busy. And if you're able to serve as much as you're able to, I'd really appreciate that. All right. And let me hand it back to Cheddars. Thanks so much, everybody. And also, I want to say hello to everybody on Twitch. Actually, let's do this real quick. Let's give a bunch of heart emoji. I'm streaming, so out of my eyeballs, the Twitch is viewing you right now. So let's put, yeah, heart emojis all across the auditorium for all our Twitch people. We got a bunch of viewers over there. So thanks so much, everybody. And Cheddars, my friend, back to you.
Thank you. That was really cool. I'll just want to point out one last thing about that volunteer spotlight is that the, you know, like some of the positions require extra time out of your week, but the live streaming position, if you're already coming to VR Church, you know, it doesn't take any extra time out of your week. It's just experiencing it with the church service with a camera in front of you. So would highly recommend. Anyways, this art piece coming up is a beautiful example of the helpful, loving spirit we want to foster in season four, even as it ends. You know, it shows how prayer, community, and destiny all work together and are anchored by love. And this whole church has been running by volunteers who have been running in that same spirit, sharing the love that comes from God. And so, because as 1 Corinthians 13:2 puts it so well, that if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but have not love, I am nothing. Irrespective if you have the ability to help and volunteer with your time, we could always use a little bit more help financially. I hear that things are going better financially these days, but just the more finances we have, the more we can grow in other areas, because as we expand the MMO church side of things on the VR MMO Discord, we find that there are some costs associated with setting up servers and stuff like that. And so any help financially would be appreciated. Yeah. And then 2 Corinthians
it's hot in a lot of the country right now. The humidity is what does me in here in Alabama. But anyway, welcome to VR Church. I'm excited to get into the book of James with you all. I think James is a pretty interesting book. James was the brother of Jesus. And it's really interesting if you really want to go down, like if you're someone that you just get really heady about theology and all of the like potential theological implications of all the, you know, all these different things, then you should look up James. We know he was the brother of Jesus. We don't know the, like the exact nature of how he was the brother of Jesus. We know he was obviously Jesus's half brother. And we know that they, were together as children, right? And so his insight here is actually really interesting because, you know, we had the disciples who wrote some of the Gospels, right? And we've got Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament. The disciples spent some time with Jesus, sort of near the end of his life for the few years of his ministry. Christ's ministry was much shorter than many of you might think that it was. It was actually very short. We've got Paul, who met Jesus face to face, right on the road to Damascus, but didn't walk with Jesus when he was here on earth. And so James, I think, is really unique and really special because he knew Jesus as a brother, like they grew up together, right? And so I think it's really interesting to get some of the wisdom from this letter that James wrote as someone who both grew up in a Jewish home, Jewish household, and also was the brother of Jesus. So this sort of interesting thing happens, right, where we just finished the book of Hebrews, and a lot of scholars attribute the book of Hebrews to Paul. But whoever wrote Hebrews, we know that they were definitely a scholar in the Torah and like the law of that time, right? Because a lot of the things in that writing, it was very clearly making the case for Jesus to those who grew up learning the Torah and the law and all of those things, saying, hey, Jesus is the fulfillment of all these things that we learned, and here's the case for that, right? This letter from James is also written to the Hebrews, is also written to that early church that was made up of people who had converted sort of from Judaism to Christianity. I almost hesitate to say a conversion. That would be how we would think about it today. But back in the day, again, the book of Hebrews makes the case that this is the same faith. It's a continuation. This is just the rest of the story. Now everything is complete and fulfilled. So they didn't view it necessarily as leaving one thing and entering another. It was more, this is just the fulfillment of what I've always learned. But James, as the brother of Jesus, was actually the leader of one of the first churches, which was composed primarily of these Hebrews. And if you look him up, you'll find out that he was often referred to as James the Just, and he was known for his wisdom, okay? And near the end of his life, which, by the way, he died as a martyr for the faith, and so that means he was killed for his faith, for his beliefs. But near the end of his life, he decided, I should write down some of the things that I think are the most important lessons for the church as a whole to know. Wisdom that I gained from being the actual, the brother of Christ and walking with him and knowing him, and that I've gained as being a church leader and just really deeply and intimately understanding Jesus as both brother and savior, right? And so he writes this letter to the church as a whole. So it's sort of unique among a lot of the letters that we see in the New Testament, because a lot of them were written, like the letters to the Ephesians were written to the church at Ephesus. The Corinthians is written to the church at Corinth. Thessalonians is written to the church at Thessalonica. But this book, James, he's writing to the church as a whole. And it's really sort of you could think of it as a brain dump, in a sense, of the wisdom that he gained over the years that he wanted to make sure that he preserved for generations to come of Christ followers. And so I think it holds sort of a special reverence for me in that sense, because this was not written to a church having very specific problems that needed addressed. This is very clearly written to everyone. The context here is he is talking to all
Christ followers. Now, he does specify Hebrews, because that was his church, right, which were Christ followers who were formerly Jews and had accepted Christ. But this wisdom is for all Christ followers, and I think that that is just really interesting. There's something really special about that. So the way that the book of James reads is actually really similar to something like the book of Proverbs. I'm not sure how many of you may have read Proverbs before. The book of Proverbs, the book of Ecclesiastes, these are considered wisdom literature in Scripture. And so the way that they're written is you get a lot of these sort of punchy one-liners that are really challenging and set out this really ideal way that one should live. And a lot of times there's this comparing and contrasting. Like in Proverbs, a lot of time you'll see something like the wise man builds his house upon the rock, but the foolish man builds his house on the sand. And you see a lot of that comparing and contrasting. And you see that in James as well, but you see it a little bit differently. What the point that James is making is someone who truly follows and accepts Christ looks like this. Someone who doesn't looks like this. And his book, his letter here, is really an encouragement to all Christ followers to make sure that you look like a Christ follower. And he lays out what a Christ follower should look like. Also, similarly to what we learned in Hebrews, these early Christians are facing a lot of persecution, right? We know that shortly after James wrote this letter, that he was martyred for his faith, right? And so he's also talks a lot about the trials and the tribulations that one might go through as a follower of Christ. And you know, this is the VR Church America service, so I'll just address this from an American point of view. If you think that there is religious persecution in America, it is nothing at all compared to what they're facing in other countries around the world and what these people face that James is writing to, right? I personally do not believe that we are persecuted for our faith in this country. Nothing like this. Their lives are literally on the line. And I want to keep that in mind when James... Actually, we can start walking that way. Let's walk that way while we finish. We're going to go over here to the beginning of James here on the left side. But I want you all to keep in mind that when James is talking about tribulations here, he's talking about rough stuff. He's talking about the types of tribulations that lead to martyrdom for people potentially laying their lives on the line for the gospel. So this is deep stuff. Now, the reason that I'm saying that is I'm not saying that to, you know, for everyone to be like, to be fearful or anything like that. What I mean for it to, is for you to understand that if he is talking about these really dark trials and tribulations that in some ways are leading to death, to help give context to whatever trials that we are going through, that these same lessons surely still apply, right? If they apply at that extreme, then they also apply to us in our trials and our tribulations that may not match that extreme. Now, I don't know all of you. Some of you may actually be facing trials to these extremes. I know people in my life who are facing really significant trials and really significant challenges in their life, right? But I just wanted to point out the severity to say that this is for everyone. This word, again, is for everyone. And I just think that that's super cool. So I would love if some folks would like to help us read. I'm going to go ahead and enable hand raising here. And I think it got turned on now. If you'd like to read with us, if you go ahead and raise your hand, I'll call on you. Wandering, if you would please read, hang on, let me look here. Wandering, if you would read to the end of verse 4 for us, please. Oh, hang on, there we go. I think I got you on.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yep.
This letter is from James, a slave of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm writing to the 12 tribes of Jewish believers scattered abroad. Greetings. Dear brothers, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, it will be perfect and complete. Meaning nothing.
Hey, it helps if I unmute myself when I start talking. All right, so he opens here. He says, this letter is from James, a slave of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the slave is the same word that is translated as the same way that we would think of slaves, right? Like, I have no choice but to be in the service of this other individual. But in this particular use, he is using it in the same way that the Jewish culture would have said that they were also a slave of God. It was something they wore as a badge of pride, right? They are saying that my identity is a servant of the Lord, and it was something that they took pride in. An opportunity for joy. I have seen other people in my life who've been through some real dark stuff, and it's really hard to consider those things an opportunity for joy. I want to tell you a story of how, especially in hindsight, I considered something very difficult that I went through. In hindsight, I consider it something that was actually really joyous, and it has changed my perspective on the trials that I go through now. And that's back when I was in high school. I was going through some stuff. I was really depressed. And I attempted to take my life one night. And I did not succeed, obviously, and thankfully. I did spend the night in the hospital. I did some counseling after. And I came to understand a lot about myself, a lot about my faith, and a lot about my God through that situation. And it's one of those things that I always can ask, why did I have this depression? Why did I have this going on in my life? Why did I have this going on in my life? God, why did you do this to me? We're going to get to that in a minute, right? But why did these things happen to me, right? And then one day I was at a church camp, and the speaker spoke out to everyone, and he said, God is kind of showing me that there is some people out there tonight that even tonight you have contemplated suicide. Even tonight at this camp, you have thought about ending your life. And if that's you, I want you to raise your hand, and I want some people to come and pray for you. And he said that, and this was you know, maybe a year or so after I'd had that experience. And it was the strangest thing. I felt this tingling, this burning sensation almost over my right shoulder. It was the weirdest thing. And, you know, as I'm looking up at the speaker, and I was kind of just trying to ignore it and, you know, shrug it off. And it was almost like it was burning. It was really bizarre. And finally, I just felt like I needed to turn around. And I looked, and there was this girl raising her hand. And she looked about my age, maybe a year or two younger. And God was like, you need to go talk to her about your experience. And so I did. I walked over to her and I said, hey, my name is Zach. Can I talk to you a little bit after service? And she said, yeah. And so after the service, we went and we sat and we talked. And she kind of opened up to me. I told her what I had been through first, right? And when I told her what I had been through, it was like something sort of unlocked for her. And she felt comfortable enough to share with me what she was going through. And I realized that all of those things that I went through changed me and put me in a position where I was able to help someone else, right? Now, over here, at the end of verse 4, we see, so let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. And I think it's a really selfish view, right, to say, I want to be perfect, so I'm going to go through this refining process, right? And I remember, I'm going to tie this together in a moment. I remember I was responsible for teaching fifth and sixth grade ministry at a church that I was a part of. And I remember asking this question, and I said, why are you all here right now? And they said, well, because this is church, and you're supposed to be in church. I said, but why? I said, you've already accepted Christ into your heart, right? Like, you've already done what you need to do. You're saved from by grace. Why are you here? Why do you need to be here? And the Holy Spirit in this conversation with them kind of showed me, well, the reason that we are in community, and the reason that we learn more, and the reason that we better ourselves, and the reason that we take joy in our trials is because it teaches us not only reliance upon God instead of reliance on ourselves, right? But in that growth within us, it makes us better able to reach other people for God's kingdom, right? So the trials that I went through, I didn't consider them a joy then. Sometimes now, when I'm going through a trial, I try to understand one day I will be able to use this to reach someone else for Christ, right? And that's why I take joy in those things as God's servant, that I can use the experiences that I've had, the positive and the negative, to reach other people for his kingdom. That's why we come together in community. That's why we continue to learn, even though we're already saved by grace. It's so that we can go out and reach more people for Christ. So, anyway, okay. we gotta go a little quicker through here. We'll be talking all night. I can be long-winded. All right, let's go from verse 5 to the end of verse 8. Marco, would you read 5 to 8 for us?
Yeah, sure. If you need wisdom, ask our generous God, and he will give it to you. He will not rebuke you for asking. But when you ask him, be sure that your faith is in God alone. Do not waver, for a person with divided loyalty is as unsettled as a wave of the sea that is blown and tossed by the wind. Such people should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Their loyalty is divided between God and the world, and they are unstable in everything they do.
All right, thank you so much. There are, in my faith experience, there are two prayers that would get you in a lot of trouble. I guess you could say three, but I hear the third one more as a joke, right? The joke I always hear is, never pray for patience. Right, I think it was actually a line in Bruce Almighty. They talked about it, right? Like, if you pray and you ask God to give you patience, does he just give you patience, or does he give you the opportunity to be patient, right? Does he put you through this refining process, right? The other one that I think is a really dangerous prayer, like, and I'm serious, I would not pray these things genuinely unless you are ready for what God will do when you say that prayer. The other prayer is to ask God to look at the world through his eyes and to see other people the way that he sees them. That will break you. It will mess you up, right? And then the third is praying and asking God for wisdom. I think it's a dangerous prayer, but I think it's dangerous in a good way. When I say dangerous, what I mean is I fully and wholeheartedly believe it begins a process that will change you and will change your life in ways that you don't understand and that you cannot possibly predict. And I actually think it's a wonderful thing, and I think you should pray those things. But I think when you pray them, you should understand, right? When you ask, be sure that your faith is in God alone. Don't waver. For a person with divided loyalty is unsettled as a wave of the sea that is blown and tossed by the wind. When you ask, be ready to be a little blown and tossed by the wind. Be ready for some crazy things to start happening as God starts to work in your heart and starts to change the way that you view and understand and interact with the world. And understand that if you ask, believe that God is going to give you that thing, right? There's not a lot of times in Scripture where it says, like, there are times when it says, ask and you'll receive. And in most cases, it's talking about these sorts of things. It's talking about asking for wisdom. It's talking about asking for those things that you need. But when you open this door and you say, God, give me wisdom, he will. And that wisdom will wreck you. It'll point out inconsistencies in who you are. When we see over here, we go back to verse 4. It says, when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. One of the things that we see in Scripture is God is someone who repairs and completes broken people. You might not realize how fragmented you are, right? That you hold a belief here, but you do this thing that is inconsistent with that belief. And I know in my life I do that even now, and I know that I'm totally ignorant to the ways and the places that I do that. But when you ask God for wisdom, and he starts exposing those things to you, and you realize that even within your own inner self, you realize that you are broken and you never realized it, how inconsistent maybe your actions were with your words, as an example, which is something that we're going to continue talking about as we get further along through chapter one. It's a really I don't want to say difficult. It's this beautiful and wonderful process, but it hurts sometimes, right? Like, one of the analogies that we see really often in scripture is that God is the potter and that we are the clay. And if you've never seen someone make a pot out of clay, I would encourage you, after service today, go to YouTube, check it out, watch what happens, because they are not gentle with that clay. They're not, right? They're not gentle with that clay. And even after they get the shape they want, they have to put it in the fire to harden it, to turn it into a ceramic that makes it durable, right? But in the end, there's a beautiful piece of art or a functional piece that is created out of that, right? So when you start praying for these things, God will do that. God will take those broken pieces and he will put them together, and he will help make you perfect and complete for the purpose of showing his glory. And it's awesome, but it's not easy, right? It's not easy. I guess that's what I mean. It's dangerous because you're putting yourself on a path that's not the easy path, but it's a path that's worthwhile. Okay, let's come over here to verse 9. This is, there's a lot here. So let's go to verses 9 to... Let's go to the end of 13. 9 to the end of 13. Eric, if you could read those for us.
Sure. Believers who are poor have something to boast about, for God has honored them. And those who are rich should boast that God has humbled them. They will fade away like a little flower in the field. The hot sun rises and the grass withers. The flower droops and falls, and its beauty fades away. In the same way, the rich will fade away with all of their achievements. God blesses those who patiently endure testing and temptation. Afterwards, they will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. And remember, when you're being tempted, do not say, God is tempting me. God is never tempted to do wrong, and he never tempts anyone.
Now, that last word there, since it's cut off, is else. He never tempts anyone else. God is never tempted, and he never tempts anyone else. Now, these verses are interesting because it really seems anti-rich, like it's against the rich. And it's even more interesting, depending on what translation you read, it actually reads even harsher against the rich. But here's the comparison that it's making. Here's what I want you to understand. Believers who are poor have something to boast about, for God has honored them. How has God honored them? One of my favorite passages in Scripture is 1 Corinthians chapter 1, it's around verse 25, where Paul says, not many of you are of noble birth. Most of you are from humble beginnings. Not many of you are wise. He basically says, look, a lot of you are poor, and a lot of you are not that bright. Right? It's a really weird thing for Paul to say to the church. But then he says, but God chose the poor to shame those with wealth. God chose the foolish to shame the wise. And what he's saying is that those perceived deficiencies from the world, that God uses those in supernatural ways to show and prove who he is through those circumstances, right? You have someone like Moses who had a speech impediment, right? It talks about in Scripture that Moses could not speak well. He couldn't give speeches. He couldn't even carry on a conversation without someone thinking, wow, this guy must be an idiot. He can't even talk. But that's who God chose to go before Pharaoh and to have his people freed and then to lead a nation and to create the foundation of the law, right? God takes these weaknesses and these flaws and he uses them to show who he is through those cracks in our facade, right? No one is perfect. And it's through our imperfections that God's power shines. Because if we didn't have imperfections, we wouldn't why do you need God, right? You're perfect, right? No one's perfect. That's the point that he's making here. And when he's talking about the wealthy, the contrast that he's making, he says, those who are poor, as an example, should be honored because God will use them to do mighty things. And those who are rich should be honored that God has humbled them and that God has shown them that their wealth will fade away, right? That one day they will die and their wealth will die with them. So what is not anti-rich, it's not anti-wealth, but what he is saying is that you have to understand that when your wealth comes from the pursuit of all of these riches, that those are going to die just like you. And nothing is permanent. And that they should boast that God has humbled them and helped them see that and helped them understand that their riches and their wealth actually mean nothing, because they will all die just as they will themselves, right? He's comparing and contrasting. And by the way, I forgot to mention this. Chapter one here, we're hitting kind of rapid fire, all these different ideas. But chapter one is actually setting the stage for the other chapters in James. This is sort of like a sneak peek. In some ways, you could think of chapter one as the table of contents for the next several chapters of James. Each little idea is going to get its own section in chapters later on to elaborate on things a little bit more. So this is sort of whetting the appetite, so to speak, spiritually, for what is to come. And he also says, God blesses those who patiently endure testing and temptation. Now, I said I'd get back to this earlier when I asked, like, God, why are these things happening to me, right? And I don't think that God causes bad things to happen, but I think God works all things to the good of those who love him, right? We see that in Romans 8:28. So I think that all things that happen, God can work his good. But when it says that God is testing, I'm going to steal this right from Francis Chan. I don't know if anybody knows who Francis Chan is, but in my research, I found Francis Chan talking about actually the beginning. He wasn't even talking about necessarily this verse. He was talking about the beginning of James and kind of the testing and trials that we endure. But other places in Scripture, it says where fire tests the purity of silver and gold. And the idea of testing that is very likely being talked about here is that same idea of fire being used to test the purity of something. And so what a metalsmith would do back in the day, if they wanted to purify silver, is they would heat it and they would melt it. And silver's pretty dense. It's the same with gold. When they would heat it and melt it, the silver would come to the bottom, and at the top would be the stuff they called the dross. And they would scoop that out. It was all of the impurities that maybe formed in with the silver. And you would do this process again and again and again until finally at some point there's no dross at the top, but at the top is a perfect mirror. The metalsmith who was testing, who was purifying the silver, could look down and they could see their own face as if it were a mirror, right? And so the idea here is that God is using these things in our life. We should take joy in them because he's using them to test us, not in a way that he is causing them to happen to us, but that he is using them to test us in a way that a metallurgist tests silver and removes these impurities until God looks down and sees himself in us, right? That's his goal as we go through this testing process. And I think that's a super beautiful analogy, because we're going to come to a verse here in a moment where James talks about what looking into a mirror. So I want you to remember this as we get to that point as well. And he also says, remember, when you are being tempted, do not say, God is tempting me. God is never tempted to do wrong. He never tempts anyone else, right? So these tests and temptations that we're going through, they're not from God. Well, where are they from then? Oh, well, they're from the devil. That's what I heard growing up. The devil, he's out to get you. He's going to be testing you. The devil's going to be tempting you. But James actually has some really interesting insight here. He says, temptation comes from our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. These desires give birth to sinful actions, and when sin's allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. Now, when I grew up in the church, I was taught that temptation comes from the devil. And whenever I was tempted to do something wrong, that was just Satan getting into my head. But if any of you are of that mind, I need to tell you that that is awful theology, and I'll tell you why. Satan does not have the attributes that God has. God is omniscient, meaning he knows everything. Satan is not, because he's not God, right? God is omnipotent. He is all-powerful. Satan is not omnipotent because there can only be one being who is omnipotent. That is God, right? And Satan is not omnipresent, which means he is everywhere at once. Only God is omnipresent. Why is that important? Well, there are 8 billion people on this planet right now. And it would be a special kind of conceit to believe that of all 8 billion people, that Satan himself has chosen you to mess with. Does that make sense? Satan can't do that. He doesn't have the power to do that, right? And so James is pointing out here, temptation comes from our own desires, right? I wish this verse had been taught on more when I was a child. Not necessarily a child, but when I was being brought up. Because there's a lot of things in my life that I tried to lay the blame on the devil when really it was my own poor decision, my own poor judgment that got me into a lot of circumstances. And I didn't take ownership for that the way that I should have, right? So that's just a sort of an interesting tidbit here. James says this temptation comes from our own desires. So I want to encourage you all to think that way, especially if you haven't before. The stuff that you might be dealing with in your life and those sorts of temptations when they come along, to look inside for a reason for why those things are happening more than looking to put that blame externally. I don't think anybody consciously does that, right? But I think that some of that broken theology can lead us to do that unintentionally. All right, I'm going to go ahead and read for us because I want to try to get through quickly. So don't be misled, my dear brothers and sisters. Whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God our Father, who created all the lights in the heavens. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. I think this is really interesting here, where it says he never changes or casts a shifting shadow. It's easy to imagine an object that doesn't change, right? But what James is saying here is that God is so consistent that even his shadow doesn't change. What changes something's shadow? Its environment, the circumstances around it would change an object's shadow. But what James is saying is that God is so firm and so constant and so unchanging that there is absolutely nothing in the circumstances around him that could even change the way his shadow is cast, right? I just think that's awesome. I think that's a really beautiful really beautiful analogy to use to talk about how God doesn't change. He chose to give birth to us by giving us his true word, and we, out of all creation, became his prized possession. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters, you must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires. And this is something that I struggle with, and if you've been around VR Church for a while, you know, because I'm always open about this struggle. I have a short temper. I have a short fuse, especially when it comes to something that I think is sort of that righteous sort of anger, right? And James does differentiate here, right? He says, human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires. That's very difficult for me sometimes to discern what's righteous anger and what's human anger. And even then, even when it's righteous anger, the instruction is be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. And that's just someplace I personally struggle with. I like to debate. I like to pick fights. I like to throw, theology grenades into conversations and see how people react. Sometimes that's fun. And sometimes it can be more damaging than I intend. And so it's difficult for me sometimes to not even, especially when I feel that sort of righteous anger, to not act out on that. So get rid of all of the filth and evil in your lives. Get rid of that dross from the top of the silver. Get rid of that. And humbly accept the word that God has planted in your hearts, for it has the power to save your souls. But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves, right? If I say, I'm a Christian and I love Jesus, but I'm super quick to anger and I don't control my tongue, I'm not slow to speak, I'm not slow to get angry, I'm fooling myself if I do this in a way that I'm unaware, right? This is one of those inconsistencies. This is what he's starting to point out. Look, God's going to make you whole, but you need to recognize, and this is what the whole book of James is about, that there are very likely inconsistencies in who you claim to be and who you are. And that as Christians, as followers of Christ, we should strive to go through this testing process to remove all that filth and evil in our lives so that we become a reflection of who God is and not who we are. Because if you listen to the word and you don't obey, it's like glancing at your own face in a mirror. You see yourself, you walk away, and you forget what you look like, right? You say, I am this person, and you look in the mirror and you say, that's who I am. That's who I claim to be. But when you walk away, you forget who you actually look like, right? Does that make sense? I know that's sort of a weird analogy. We want to reflect God. We want to reflect Christ, right? But what he's saying is if our actions don't match our words, right? If our actions don't match our faith, then we're really just looking at ourselves and we don't know who we really are because we're claiming to be someone that we're not. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free and you do what it says and you don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. Now, special note here, right? It doesn't say then you will be saved, right? We've talked before that all it takes is that faith to become saved, right? We talk about John 3:16, and John 3:15 talks about Moses lifting up this snake in the book of Numbers, and that everyone who looked on that snake, that they were saved from this plague of snakes that was happening in their camp, right? So that's in John 3:15. And John 3:16 says, well, that's how God loved the world, that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in that son won't perish, right? So it's already been established that all we need to do is look in God's direction and pursue God, and that's where our salvation comes from. But if we look into that law that sets us free and we do what it says and we don't forget what we heard, then we will also be blessed. If you claim to be religious, but you don't control your tongue, and we're going to talk more about the tongue in the book of James as well. James talks about the tongue many times, right? Be slow to speak, control your tongue. You're fooling yourself, and your religion is worthless. This is one of the most beautiful verses to close out James and to close us out for today in the entire Bible. James, brother of Jesus, leader of one of the first churches in Christianity, right? James the Just, who was revered for his wisdom and his leadership, says in James chapter 1, verse 27, pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress and refusing to let the world corrupt you, right? This verse 27 stands alone from everything else that James said in this chapter, yet at the same time hits everything else that he said in this chapter, because he is comparing and contrasting all of these different things, right? The rich and the poor, as an example, in their relationship with Christ, right? Those whose faith, whose actions follow their faith, and those who don't. He talks about all these things, and he sets up all this other stuff for the rest of his letter beautifully. And then right here at the end of the setup for his letter, here's the home run right here. Pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress and refusing to let the world corrupt you. It echoes what Jesus said. The greatest command is to love the Lord God with all your heart, mind, and soul. And the second is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and prophets rest on these, Jesus said. Meaning, if you love God and you love your neighbor the way that you love yourself, if you just do those two things, then everything else, all the law, all the prophet, you don't have to worry about all of that because you're on the right track. You will automatically do all of the things you need to do if that's the way that you live your life. And I think that's amazing, and I think that's beautiful. And I'm going to pray to close us out in the book of James, if that's okay. Or did we have someone else that was going to pray, DJ?
I'll go ahead.
We thank you.
Sorry, good.
God, we thank you so much for your word. And we thank you so much for preserving through time this wisdom from James, who knew you as Jesus, who knew you intimately as a brother and as a savior. And I thank you so much for this wisdom that has been passed down to us, God. And I ask that as we look at chapter 1 in James, and as we continue next week in chapter 2 and through the rest of the book, God, that these statements, this wisdom that James left for us, God, that it would cut into us, God, that it would expose those fractures that we have in our mind, those differences, God, between who we want to be and claim to be as servants of you and who we really are. I ask that you would expose those, that you would give us wisdom, that you would give us grace, and that you would mend those fractures so that we would look more like you, God, that you would test us like that silver. You would pull those things out of our life so that when others look at us, when you look at us, God, that we reflect back who you are and not just who we claim to be. Because we, God, inevitably we will fail, but we want to look like you. And I thank you for everything that you have done in and through VR and MMO Church, and everything that you're going to continue to do in and through this. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Thank you, everybody.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Zach. Appreciate it, man, my friend. Yeah, Zach, thanks so much for opening up the letter of James to us. And I think you're on for chapter 2 next week, right? So you'll continue this
narrative. I am indeed, yeah.
Yeah, that'll be awesome. Thanks so much, Zach. Really appreciate that, man. Really appreciate teaching us tonight. All right, my friends. We know we're in overtime. We usually do some Q&A, but we'll save that for next week. Maybe we'll try to get some extra time for Q's and A's. Next Sunday. But here's what we do after church usually is we go to this world called Prayer World. And this is Zeke has got this portal set up for you. And here's what you do at the top of the hill. That's where we hang out, chat, be as loud as you want. But if you go down the hill, there's a little arch. And when you go through that arch, that's where people are going to be praying. So if you venture that far, make sure to keep it quiet and be respectful down there. Zeke will be down there praying. I think Carrie is going to be there praying. Star Child will be there as well. So we have two or three prayer team down there. So look for Zeke, Carrie, and Star Child if you need prayer. And there might be some other prayer leaders here. Just, you know, maybe Carrie, Zeke, or Star Child, you could let people know. So, yeah, let's all hang out and chat. And then if you go down to the hill, look for one of the prayer people and just let them know you would like some prayer about something that's going on. So, all right. Thanks, everybody. James chapter 2 next week. Nothing but love. Good to see everybody. I hope you're doing well. And we can launch that portal whenever you're ready, Zeke. All right, Twitch. We'll catch you later, Twitch. Have a great week. Be safe. Have fun. Don't forget to have some fun. Need a little you time. A little self-care. Don't be working too hard now. Oh, thanks, Phantom. I appreciate that. Y'all have a great week, everybody.
Hello.
And we'll see you next week.
Hello.